Hello, everyone, and welcome. We're excited that so many of you could join us today for On the Therapeutic Applications of Ketamine. I'm Jason MacArthur, the Events Coordinator for the Public Programs Department of the California Institute of Integral Studies, a nonprofit university in San Francisco. Now, let me first introduce our presenters, Raquel Bennett and Gisele Fernandes-Osterhold, and then we'll get right to the conversation. Gisele Fernandes-Osterhold is a licensed psychotherapist, clinical supervisor, and graduate-level psychology professor. Being an immigrant to the United States and a woman of color, Gisele developed a profound interest in multicultural issues, which is one of the main topics of her work. Gisele's personal approach to healing is rooted in her commitment to embodied spirituality, informed by her practices of yoga, dance, and indigenous traditions of her native Brazil. She serves as core faculty member in the Integral Counseling Psychology Program at CIIS, a mentor at the Center for Psychedelic Therapies and Research at CIIS, and a clinical supervisor at the SAGE Institute. Raquel Bennett is a psychologist and ketamine specialist with 19 years of experience in working with ketamine. She is the founder of CRIA Institute and CRIA Conference, which are both devoted to the use of ketamine in psychiatry and psychotherapy. Dr. Bennett has given hundreds of lectures and trained thousands of practitioners on working with ketamine in clinical practice. She is best known for articulating different approaches to ketamine treatment and for authoring the ethical guidelines for ketamine clinicians. And now, let me turn it over to Gisele and Raquel.
Good evening, everybody. It's wonderful to be here with you, Raquel, tonight, and to open up this spring series on psychedelic-assisted psychotherapy. Such an important conversation, such a hot topic these days with a lot of movement towards decriminalization and legalization of the medical use of psychedelics with psychotherapy. And welcome, so glad to have you here.
I'm delighted to be here. Thank you so much for inviting me.
Yeah, so ketamine has been classified with psychedelic drugs, even though it's not a classical psychedelic like psilocybin, LSD, or DMT. Can you define what ketamine is?
Sure, happy to do that. Ketamine is a medicine that was first synthesized as a surgical anesthetic for humans. It's actually a derivative of PCP or angel dust. Ketamine has some properties in common with classical psychedelics in that ketamine can produce an altered state of consciousness that helps, that gives people an enhanced sense of connection to other people and to the potentially to the whole universe, and can also help bring material that is buried in the psyche, help bring it to the surface. So in that sense, it's similar. But ketamine is quite different from the other psychedelics that you mentioned, the classical psychedelics. It seems to be primarily active in the glutamate pathway, as opposed to the other medicines that have a lot of activity in the serotonin pathway. And ketamine is dissociative, so it quiets the signals from one's body and has pain modulating properties. It's also quite a bit flatter, I think. It has a much flatter experience than the other classical psychedelics. The other medicines tend to amplify people's experience of their own body and of their emotions. And ketamine does exactly the opposite. It quiets the experience of your own body, and it tends to quiet your own or kind of compress your emotional range. And that's really quite useful for some of the therapeutic applications.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so ketamine historically has been used by in the medical field as an anesthetic, and it also has had a history of a fun drug, right? A party drug. But now we're here tonight to discuss a different way in which ketamine is used, which is as an adjunct to psychotherapy. Mm-hmm. And would you like to speak a little bit about that in terms of how is this legal substance that has been used in different settings is now beginning to be used for psychotherapy and is present in many clinics, and there's a wide variety of ways in which this work is being developed.
Yeah, I would love to talk about this. Thank you for asking. Ketamine is a really flexible tool, and it can be used in a variety of ways. And all of them, a variety of ways, specifically in psychiatry and psychotherapy and for psycho-spiritual exploration. And all of them are valid and all of them are useful some of the time. So let me outline this for your listeners. Let's see, one way of thinking about ketamine as a for a mood disorder or for a psychological exploration, one way of thinking about it is as a pharmaceutical alone, focusing on what ketamine does at a biochemical level. And there's no doubt that ketamine does something at a chemical level, at an organic level, that seems to be helpful for people with severe and refractory and recurrent depressive disorders, and for people who have obsessional thought patterns or something on the OCD spectrum, and for a couple of other disorders. Definitely does something that's chemical. But that's not the whole story with ketamine. That's only part of it. Another way of thinking about ketamine is to use it as a lubricant for psychotherapy in a way that's really similar to what MAPS is studying now with respect to MDMA and the treatment of PTSD. So in this other way of thinking about ketamine, we're using it as a lubricant. The ketamine is a catalyst for exploration in the psychotherapy process. So that's more of a psychological approach to working with ketamine, where it's doing something at a chemical level also, but where accessing and verbally processing emotional and psychological material is really the focus of that kind of work. There's a third way also of using ketamine, which is to use it to fully induced psychedelic journeys or fully dissociative experiences. And in that case, you're actually inviting in as a provider and as a team, the provider and the client, you're actually on purpose inducing dissociative and psychedelic experience with the intent of inviting visions, inviting non-ordinary visions to come into the patient's body and mind with the idea that those visions are potentially useful. So in that case, you're actually working in a fully psychedelic range. So that's the thing. When we talk about ketamine treatment, we should be clear about whether we're conceptualizing the conversation at a biological level, at a psychological and relational level, or at a psychedelic and shamanic level. In reality, they all interact with each other. There's interplay there, but I think it's important to start from that point in having this conversation.
Wonderful. Thank you for being so clear and differentiating these different therapeutic approaches with ketamine use. And so here I'm understanding there's different models of healing and different protocols depending on the therapeutic effect that one might want to have for the patient, and depending on the patient too.
Right.
So we will, throughout this conversation, talk about some of the indications and counterindications, some of the ways of the training, some of the ways in which these three different models, whether it's the biological use, the chemical use of ketamine, the lubricant for psychotherapy, more in a catalyst relational way, or in a psychedelic way. Mm-hmm. When we look at these three different models and three different paradigms of healing, would you say something about the ways in which these effects get produced in the body? So there's something about dose and intake. And so just to get the audience a little bit clued in of how come the same medicine can provide such different effects?
Yeah, that's a great question. Actually, the effects are overlapping. That's the thing. They're all sort of happening at the same time. But you know, on a chemical level, ketamine produces an antidepressant effect for people with certain kinds of depression, not every kind of depression, that lasts probably about 2 weeks. The effect is, you know, when it's done correctly, the effect is more prominent for about 7 days, and then a little bit more subtle for another 7 days. So probably the chemical effect probably lasts about 2 weeks. But it's really hard to measure how long the effect lasts or how durable it is when people are untangling knots on the inside. When people have a chance to express material that has been troubling them or that feels locked up, and they move through that or release that or have new insight about that, that can potentially exert a benefit, a therapeutic effect, something that feels helpful for months or years, decades sometimes. We're just beginning to see that. And we don't have great data because we haven't been asking the right questions about that. But clearly we're hearing from patients and former patients that sometimes they get something that they need out of ketamine facilitated psychotherapy that has an enduring effect. And similarly with psychedelic ketamine, which I think of as a sort of a distinct phenomenon from ketamine facilitated psychotherapy. People sometimes have visions that they describe as some of the most meaningful and some of the most information rich and some of the most enjoyable experiences of their entire lives. So what do you do with that when people are still chewing on their experience, still deriving benefit from the meaning or from the direction of those visions? And literally decades later, they're still talking about it and still finding it informative and helpful. One could say that the psychedelic journeys that they had, when they're held in a really tender and beautiful way, that they exert an effect that lasts an immeasurable amount of time. So I think this is a really interesting question for research, is to begin to do longitudinal studies to begin to have better data about this phenomenon.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so what you're saying is, when viewed through a psychedelic paradigm, the ketamine can bring people into a non-ordinary state of consciousness, and in that it will potentially disrupt their mental structures and reorient them to their own self-narratives, and perhaps bring personal meaningful experiences that are long-lasting.
In some cases, and in other cases, when people are not adequately prepared, or it's not the right medicine at the right time, or it's not the right dose, or the setting isn't optimal, then people sometimes have experience that's very frightening and psychologically distressing. So that's possible too. Mm-hmm. We don't see that so much in therapeutic ketamine when it's administered by a team of medical and mental health professionals, but certainly people have reported that, particularly when they're doing psychedelic exploration on their own.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's thread slowly through all these different subjects here. So to start out, right, if somebody is interested in ketamine work, for who is ketamine indicated for?
Yeah, that's a good question. So according to, by the way, I keep beeping. Is that an issue? Let me know if that's a problem.
No.
No, you're not hearing it? Okay, great. Fantastic. So according to the academic research literature, ketamine is clinically indicated for people who have five possible diagnoses. And those are called the big five in ketamine treatment. Let me say what those are. Those are people who have severe and refractory depressive disorders that are recurrent, or people who have bipolar depression, or people who have physical pain with depression. That's a pretty common combination. People who have been diagnosed with true OCD, or people who have what's called ruminative suicidal ideation. And I just want to make a quick note about that. Ruminative suicidal ideation is actually not suicidal ideation in response to a clear stressor, but rather it has a ruminative and obsessive quality to it, so that people are hearing a thought in their mind that's telling them to hurt themselves, and they find that distressing. And very often people don't share that with other people, that they're not threatening to kill themselves, but rather they're having an experience that often gets revealed in psychotherapy treatment. And that particular kind of ruminative self-harm thought is very responsive to ketamine treatment. Anyway, because there's so much literature on these five indications, there's been so much research on it, that it's pretty darn safe as a clinician to administer ketamine for one of those indications. You're on solid legal ground. There's a couple of other things that we're looking at as possible indications for ketamine treatment. Those are considered the investigational indications. That means that we think it probably works, or where we think that ketamine is probably helpful, but where there's not a lot of literature yet. But let me say what some of those are. That list would include probably some kinds of disordered eating, probably depression in older adults, probably depression in adolescents, severe, you know, refractory depression, probably pretty useful in hospice or when people are contemplating their own deaths, probably useful in treating a severe postpartum depression in women. So those are new articles and new research coming out on these things. So that's really exciting. And I think we're going to see more about that. Then there are a couple of places where clinicians are using ketamine where I think they should be using a lot of caution. So on that list of things where ketamine might be useful, but you got to do it really carefully. Couple things. That might include PTSD or trauma. That would include substance use disorders. And it would probably include anxiety disorders or a lot of anxiety. Probably ketamine is not the optimal tool for some of those things, but it's what we have available now. And so you just got to make the most of what you got.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Go ahead.
Well, just to add, you know, that really the core question here, the key thing is it legal and is it useful for people to use ketamine in their own personal exploration or in their psycho-spiritual exploration in the absence of psychiatric symptoms? What if you don't have a psychiatric diagnosis? Is ketamine still useful? And I think that all the clinicians who have been working with this for many years, as I have, would say that it's probably pretty useful. But the question is it legal? Are you allowed as a prescriber or as a therapist to offer or suggest or prescribe ketamine treatment for someone who doesn't have a refractory disorder? And this is a tricky area. Right now, you're allowed to give ketamine when it's clearly clinically indicated. And you know, who decides what that means? That's a very loaded and culturally embedded concept. So anyway, what needs to happen in this field is we need to have more research and literature that documents the helpfulness and effectiveness of ketamine for people wanting to do psychological work and psycho-spiritual exploration. We need that written down. We need case reports, and we need studies on this. And that's what's going to move the field forward to make it possible to have this treatment more accessible to more people who want it.
Yeah. So a couple of comments there. When I think about the clinical indications for ketamine use, and you're talking about the five most common and documented and research indications, but also some other ways in which ketamine is now being used. And in looking at our local centers here in the Bay Area, the Polaris Insight Center, Healing Realms, the Center for Transformational Psychotherapy, Temenos, Sage Integrative Health, and Sage Institute, all of those have as part of their website and their offerings to work with PTSD. Mm-hmm. And so, and it's an area that you are here saying that hasn't been as well researched, but it's definitely something that can be explored. And I'm reading Resma Manikin's book, My Grandmother's Hands, and so beautiful the way in which he contextualized trauma as part of everybody's lives, especially if we look into racial trauma in this country. And so, you know, the idea that we're all traumatized and that we're all in some way in a healing journey, then it puts trauma on this different way of conceptualizing. And leads me into asking you the next question, because I think a lot of what you're saying is based on the safety and integrity of using the medicine in the best way possible for best outcomes. So do you want to talk a little bit, let's perhaps zoom in a little bit on the model that would be either a relational model where ketamine can be used as an adjunct to psychotherapy or a psychedelic journey. In both senses, we're talking about a model of treatment where there is a clinician involved, a psychotherapist or a psychologist, as well as a medical professional, being a doctor or a nurse or a psychiatrist. And so it's a multidisciplinary team. It happens at a clinic. And there's a process in which this work happens. Do you want to highlight a few of the elements that you think are important for best successful treatment?
Well, sure. It's clear to me that that optimal treatment looks like having somebody with a medical background, some sort of medical professional, who can be attentive to the patient's medical and physical safety during this whole process. So a medical professional who is assessing the patient before receiving ketamine, someone, the same person who's available in case there's something adverse happens during the ketamine administration, and someone who's available to follow up with the patient, who's working in collaboration with a psychotherapist who's responsible for diagnosing the patient, thinking about an integrative treatment plan before you start ketamine, but thinking about what that patient really needs, who's also available to be with the patient and provide psychological support if needed during the actual ketamine administration, and then who's available to do the really essential work, psychological work after the medicine administration, in what's sometimes called integration or follow-up care. So this is not unique to ketamine. This is actually, I think, applicable to all of these powerful psychoactive visionary medicines. But anyway, I just wrote about this. I wrote a document called The Ethical Guidelines for Ketamine Clinicians that outlines the roles and responsibilities of the different kinds of professionals. But ideally, people are working together. Medical and mental health professionals are working together to make sure that this is both medically and psychologically safe for patients. Mm-hmm. There's a lot to know, but it's, anyway, that would be a starting place, that document.
Yeah, so we are here discussing a model where the patient is in psychotherapy mm-hmm. and ketamine is a part of their treatment. And either that psychotherapy is done within the center that they will get their treatment, or they have a psychotherapist and that psychotherapist works in conjunction with the center and the clinical staff and doctors in which the patient will get that treatment. And so psychotherapy is always a part of the intervention, because we're talking about a concept of healing that is a little bit broader than just injecting a medicine and feeling chemically better. We're talking about a concept of healing that includes a preparation for entering deeper realms of one's psyche, of perhaps getting in touch with wounds, of developing more trust relationally, of being able to open up to areas that one hasn't been able to access, perhaps in their own healing journey. And that takes time and takes a space and takes preparation. And then you have the journey itself, which may have elements of a psychedelic journey. And then there is the aftermath of what does one do with this material that got evoked, with these visions that maybe someone saw, or with these memories that one might have revisited. And it's in the process of integration and processing and talking about it that the healing really comes together.
Well said. Well said. That's the thing too, is that ketamine makes learning more potent, we think. Mm-hmm. And that's not a surprise, because glutamate, which is one of the neurotransmitters involved here, is essential in other kinds of learning and memory processing. But anyway, the presence of ketamine opens people up to a special kind of learning. And so there's a unique opportunity there to do some psychological rewiring, I think. And so, you know, that's the thing, is that ultimately the goal of treatment, in my opinion, is to help people learn new psychological skills or add to their toolkit such that they can help themselves going forward. What we don't need is a whole bunch of people who need more drugs, chemicals, and medications ongoing. A small fraction of people will need that, but not everybody needs that. And so the thing is how do people acquire new skills? Well, that they have to be taught. And so I think that's why pairing ketamine with psychotherapy is so potent. In addition to that, so much of the pain in this life comes from relationships, and having the opportunity to revisit that or work through that with another person who is well-trained and open-hearted and receptive, that's a really valuable opportunity. And so there's something there that I think that makes ketamine treatment optimal with a therapist or guide.
Wonderful. So we're on the same page. However, there are some models, and I just want you to shine some light into that, because in case people look at research, they will see that on a chemical level, on a biological level, a lot of clinics and doctors have worked with these six sessions, right? Six injections yeah. for a certain number of time, a certain period of time, and have gotten a certain result, a clinical result that is both very effective for suicidality and treatment-resistant depression. And so could you mention that a little bit? It's a different paradigm, but since we're looking at the medicine, yeah.
Yeah, I think you're referring to the Diamond and McShane protocol of the six infusions in 2 or 3 weeks. I think that's what you're talking about. Yes. And okay, so let's look at this from a historical perspective. The thing is that there was some evidence probably 30 years ago that ketamine might have some mood modulating properties, but everybody was afraid of it because it had psychedelic properties also. And in the early research, the fact that ketamine might induce a non-ordinary state of consciousness, might induce visions or make people feel twinkly or far out, that was considered a bad thing, a problematic side effect. They called it psychotomimetic. That means that they thought that state mimicked psychosis, which of course it doesn't. Don't even get me started on that, because that's a whole nother, let's not go down that rabbit hole. But anyway, what happened was mental health professionals wanted to work with ketamine, but they weren't really that familiar with this tool. The people who got the most training are anesthesiologists and ER docs and other people who work in that part of the medical field. So they borrow from anesthesiology, and these early researchers came up with a protocol of giving 0.5 milligrams per kilogram of body weight of ketamine to a patient on infusion, on a 40-minute infusion. There's nothing magical about 40 minutes. They did that for the researchers' convenience, and they saved it outright so that they could change patients on the hour. So that's where the 40 minutes came from. But anyway, they were giving these patients these low doses of ketamine for mood modulation or for treating depression, specifically with the explicit intent that psychedelic or psychotomimetic experience was bad. It was a problematic side effect to be avoided. And so the way they avoided it was either to dose under the psychedelic effect or to medicate it if it occurred, to give benzodiazepines to prevent the visions. Because there was a fundamental bias against psychospiritual experience. So they came up with this low dose protocol, and it works okay for some folks. The problem is that the dose is a little on the low side and it wasn't very durable. The effect didn't last long enough. So anyway, eventually somebody came up with the idea of packing six sessions close together. Originally it was Monday, Wednesday, Friday for 2 weeks. So giving six low dose infusions in a cumulative series, the idea was, the concept here was to get enough medication, enough ketamine into the patient's body to do the magic thing that ketamine does, but while trying to avoid psychedelic experience in any individual session. That was the premise of this treatment. Okay, if you do a clustered series like that, you might get up to a couple months of symptom relief for severe and refractory depression. But here's the problem. There's two problems with this model, the number of problems with this model. So problem number one is that the patient is rendered passive. They're not called upon to do anything to participate in their own treatment. They are the patient in this conceptually is a passive recipient of the medication, and they and all they do is show up for the appointment. And this kind of passivity, the patient sort of doing nothing on their own behalf, is a great model for certain kinds of medical interventions like surgery. But we have to wonder if that's a great model for someone who's having a chronic mental health difficulty. I actually think that empowering people to be as active as possible in their own treatment is a good thing. But the other problem is that the effect is temporary and you're really just sort of band-aiding over it. It's kind of like if you have weeds on your lawn, do you want to just keep mowing the grass? Or do you want a more durable solution where you actually pull the weeds up by the roots, which I think is more analogous to ketamine facilitated psychotherapy, where you actually begin to deal with the roots of the problem with an attempt to try to resolve it. Anyway, all of that to say that passive position, the patient, and the effect is temporary. Those are some of the limitations of this medical model that has been so heavily researched. Mm-hmm. That said, there are some advantages to it. The main one is that makes ketamine treatment accessible for people who are medically complicated. So I want to just be clear that we absolutely do refer people out for low-dose ketamine infusion when it's necessary. There's absolutely a place for that. But I would be very concerned. I would be wary of clinicians who want to sell you this model and don't mention the fact that integrative treatment is needed, that other kinds of interventions are needed, and that there's another way of doing it, namely ketamine-facilitated therapy or psychedelic ketamine. And here's the problem. Some providers, some ketamine infusion providers are coming from a beautiful place in their hearts where they really want to be helpful, and I can see that. But for other providers, we have to not fool ourselves. We have to be honest about the fact that it's financially beneficial to someone who's an infusion provider to provide these infusions ongoing. If the patient needs the treatment for a long period of time, the clinician benefits economically. And so that's a conflict of interest that I think has to be named when we assess these different treatments and their efficacy. Mm-hmm. So the ketamine infusion is usually devoted to symptom reduction or symptom management, and ketamine facilitated psychotherapy has a slightly different goal, as I said, to get more to the roots of the issue.
So here, what you're saying is that providers should be familiar with the different strategies that they can consider in relationship to the client diagnosis and what's most clinically indicated. And in these different models, there's also different concepts of healing embedded in these different models, right? And you're mentioning IV, and I think a lot of people may be afraid of that. Like, I don't want an injection. So there's different ways to actually get ketamine into the body.
Right.
Yeah, so would you say a little bit more about that in terms of the different ways that the ketamine can get to the body and the doses and yeah.
Yeah, I'm happy to answer that question. I also want to highlight something that you just said, which is the premise of CIIS Institute and CIIS Conference. The premise, the bottom line is that I believe that ketamine clinicians and ketamine providers should be familiar with all of the dosing strategies for ketamine and all of the different routes of administration. And they should take the time to explain to each patient why they're choosing the route and the dose that they're choosing or what they're recommending. They should be making referrals out if the patient needs something different than what they can provide, et cetera. But yeah, I think all clinicians should be familiar, should consider taking some training and be familiar with the whole spectrum of ketamine services. So with respect to route, ketamine is a little teeny tiny molecule that easily crosses the blood-brain barrier. And so that means that you can get it into your body in a whole lot of ways. The most efficient ways to get ketamine into your body is to have infusion where the ketamine is put into a bag that's fed into a needle that's placed in a vein. And then the next most efficient way of working with ketamine is as an injection put into a big muscle. So in both of those cases, more than 90% of the ketamine makes it to the patient's brain to do the job that it was intended to do. But not everybody has access to that for a variety of reasons. And so there are some other ways that you can work with ketamine. You can insufflate it or put it into your nose. That's how the S-ketamine product is delivered. You can put it into, have it compounded, have it made into a lozenge. It's essentially a medicated piece of candy that you would hold in your mouth, and the absorption is called transbuccal. It goes across, it goes through the membranes of your mouth and into the capillaries and then into the circulatory system. It can be swallowed, which is very inefficient. It can be applied to the skin, also very inefficient. It can be compounded into a suppository, also highly variable. The problem is that all these routes that I just mentioned are less than 50% bioavailable. What I mean is less than 50% of the medicine actually makes it to the person's brain. And the effect is really variable. That means that it varies from day to day and hour to hour and person to person. So this is really a clinical problem. It's really, it's actually somewhat undesirable. I mean, again, if this is all you've got, then you make it work. But people should be aware that different routes of administration for ketamine have different effects. And again, ideally we would match the route and the treatment to each patient based on what they need.
And in an overall sense, broadly speaking, Raquel, with these different routes of administration, how would the person feel better? When would they feel better? Are there research that indicates that, you know, there's a certain effect right away or the next day, or how long does it last? Would you talk a little bit about that?
Oh, those are some big questions. I'll tell you what I've observed. When people are exposed to ketamine, they usually, and they have certain kinds of organic symptoms. So that's a small subsection of people. They usually feel better right away. Within the first 10 minutes of ketamine exposure, there's a little bit of improvement or lift. And then people tend to feel another energetic uplift a couple of hours after ketamine administration. So, you know, with injectable ketamine, which is what we use the most in my practice, that's typically 4 to 6 hours post-injection. And then there's another blossoming of ketamine. There's another kind of like solidification of the effect, probably 2 to 3 days after ketamine treatment. It takes that amount of time for the effect to fully blossom. And then that can last, as I said, 7 to 14 days from a single ketamine exposure. Our best guess at this point is that these different intervals that I've just mentioned probably correspond to things happening in different chemical pathways. So probably the serotonin pathway, the dopamine pathway, the glutamate pathway, and the opioid pathway are probably involved, and the effect is probably kind of taking hold at different times. And I'm excited for when the neuroscience catches up with us and can better explain that. But there's a couple of really important things that we can extract from these observations. First thing is that people probably don't need, if the dose is optimal and the setting is optimal, okay? So when those conditions are met, people probably don't need ketamine treatment more than twice a month at the most. So people who are doing ketamine more frequently than that, either something's not right with the dosing or something's not right with the setup, or something else is going on there that needs to get looked at. So that's one thing to notice. Another thing is that how can you possibly assess ketamine's effect if you haven't waited the full 2 or 3 days to see what it's going to do? So the idea of taking ketamine every day makes no sense to me clinically. And so I want to draw some attention to that question. Mm-hmm. I just want to say one more thing, which is that when people are first getting treatment for depression, they need ketamine more frequently. It's called the induction phase. At first, it takes more to lift someone out of a depression mm-hmm. than it does to kind of keep them on the road. In other words, if the truck goes off the road and into the mud, it takes more energy to get it back on the road than it does to keep the truck on the road in the first place, if that makes any sense.
Yes.
All that to say is that if someone is really severely depressed for a long period of time, they might need ketamine, you know, probably twice a week for a couple weeks. And then they should move into a maintenance phase of ketamine. You don't stay at that high frequency forever. That's something's not right there if that's what's happening. But rather in a maintenance phase, people come back for ketamine treatment for a booster. Sometimes they want to come back once a year, so annually. Sometimes they want to come back quarterly, a couple times a year. Some people need to come back monthly, so you know, once a month for more ketamine. Occasionally we have people that need to be seen more frequently than that. But I just want to put that out there so that people can be, you know, thinking about what they're getting and what they need, and do they need to make a change to their regimen so that it's closer to optimal.
Mm-hmm. And for some patients, if they are under another regimen of medication, that would be combined with a ketamine treatment?
Like, do you mean like conventional oral medication?
Yes, antidepressants, for example.
Yeah. So it depends on the medicine, and it depends on the patient, and it depends on the provider. Ketamine plays well with a lot of psychiatric medications, but not all of them. So most of the time, people can continue on their regular oral meds as needed. But again, that would have to be decided on a case-by-case basis. And I want to just point out that that's one of the advantages of ketamine treatment, as compared with something like MDMA or psilocybin, where the patient might have to go off their SSRIs. I think that's still being debated. But ketamine plays okay with most SSRIs. Rather, they don't have a negative interaction. So people can stay on their meds during ketamine treatment. And that's a real plus for a lot of people in this population.
So since you're comparing ketamine with these other psychoactive medicines, it also distinguishes from the classical psychedelics, please correct me if I'm wrong, that the ketamine doesn't bring up so much the anxiety and the fear and that intensity of the life and death as you go through the journey. It's a little bit more gentle medicine. And it has a shorter half-life and also a quicker onset. So how do you see these elements of ketamine as, for example, in combination with psychotherapy as perhaps a little bit easier to work with, or more adaptable to certain populations or to clinicians? Yeah. Can you say something about that?
Sure. Let's see here. God, there's a lot in there, a lot of interesting points. I'm not sure that I would agree that ketamine is gentler than other medicines. The experience of being disconnected from your own body and the fully dissociative and psychedelic experience of ketamine can potentially be very intense, and often causes people to think that they're dying or that they have died, which can be very intense and or distressing if people are not adequately prepared for that or not feeling adequately supported. It's true, ketamine has a little bit less chaos, I think. I sort of think of psilocybin and LSD as being kind of swirly into the chaos, and ketamine is doesn't exactly have that property for most people. But anyway, the effect is dose dependent. But ketamine, it really is ideally suited for lots of therapeutic applications. It works really well, as I said, for primary organic depression. But what's good about it is that it's rapid acting and it wears off fairly quickly, so that can be used in a therapy session that lasts a couple of hours, whereas MDMA or psilocybin or LSD, it kind of takes the whole day. You know, it's hard to fit that into a single or double psychotherapy session. So the rapid acting nature of ketamine makes it a good adjunct for psychotherapy.
And I want to just emphasize here what you just said, that the experiences induced by ketamine that are similar to those produced by psychedelics, the sense of the luminous, the out of the body experience, the ego dissolution, those can be very scary. And the key here is really the right set and setting, the careful preparation, a safe relationship with the provider. And so these experiences that are can be very precious and very transformative, are not creating traumatic responses, but rather healing opportunities.
Agreed. I mean, there's so much to say about that. And to add to that, you know, the fact that ketamine is so rapid acting and can be such an intense experience packed into such a short period of time, I think that's one of the reasons why it's used in an unsupervised way. I hate the word recreational, but you know what I mean. Mm-hmm. And why it can be a drug of abuse, because you can, you know, sort of fit it into a short slot. And I think that's one of the appeals of this medicine. And so, you know, it's a double-edged sword, right? The thing that makes it incredibly powerful and useful is also something that leads people down a bad road sometimes.
Mm-hmm. Do you want to say more about that, about either addiction or challenges of using ketamine unsupervised?
Sure. This is such an interesting question. Do I think that ketamine is inherently addictive? Does it pull for addiction? I don't think that it does. There's so much evidence that it's been used for literally millions of people for medical and psychotherapeutic applications where the people or the clients express no interest in using ketamine, you know, in between their medical sessions. So I don't know that it's inherently addictive, but certainly people do become addicted. And that can be really difficult. Some people get addicted to, or you know, are attracted to, or become obsessed with being disconnected from the struggles of everyday life, or whatever physical or psychological pain that they're experiencing. So I think all these very powerful tools can potentially the people can be in an addictive relationship with them. And then on top of that, COVID certainly has amplified and exacerbated all of this in some really concerning ways. I've been doing this 19 years, and I have not heard of so much ketamine addiction until pretty recently. So it's hard to sort of parse out what is situational and what is, you know, a property of the chemical. So I think we'll have to figure that out as we go forward. In the meantime, I hope that people who are struggling with ketamine addiction have access to care and compassion. And I just want to point out that there are a couple of things that we need to be worried about. Ketamine is an incredibly useful and beautiful medicine and an ally of mine. But when it's used incorrectly, there are a number of things that can go wrong. Let's just take a second to talk about that. Mm-hmm. Accidents. People can fall down the stairs or injure themselves. Using ketamine driving under the influence of ketamine could lead to a very serious bad outcome for the user or for other people in the community. People have drowned under the influence of unsupervised ketamine. So injuries and death are something that we should be talking about. Tolerance. If you use ketamine too frequently, you need more and more to get the same effect. So you don't see that in supervised ketamine use, but I hear about it quite a bit from people who are using it unsupervised. So tolerance is a problem we should be concerned about. Diversion is a problem that we should be concerned about. That means when the ketamine ends up in the hands of somebody for whom it was not prescribed and where it might be dangerous for that person, diverted medically or psychologically. That's a concern here. And finally, functional damage. Too much ketamine exposure puts people at a high risk for cystitis, which is the medical term for damage to the kidneys or bladder. And that can be a very painful problem, urinary problem with a lot of suffering and hard to treat. So we want to be careful about that. People need to think about their overall ketamine exposure so that they are staying healthy and safe.
Yeah, thank you for bringing up these adverse outcomes with ketamine use and some of the safety that is important to consider here. And you're highlighting the challenges in people's mental health with the pandemic and something about using ketamine unsupervised, and it's less ideal and it doesn't pertain to this model that we're discussing here. So in the best case scenario, there is a psychotherapy happening. There are providers that are helping the patient be prepared, not only for the ketamine session, but also for the process as a whole, as we've been talking about here, ways of healing depression or anxiety or trauma are not, cannot be condensed to just a chemical intake or a few chemical intakes, but rather a whole investigation and a holding and supportive container for the unfoldment and the healing process. But you know what comes up a lot of times is how accessible is this, right? Mm-hmm, so if mm-hmm. we're talking about, mm-hmm. you know, I'll have a therapist, I'll have a doctor who's going to oversee, or there will be a psychiatrist or a nurse. This is going to be in a clinic. There will be a number of sessions before, during, after, for the time that the experience is happening. There is a holding environment with music, with attunement. This is expensive, right? So can we talk a little bit about cultural considerations around ketamine treatment and accessibility?
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up. Let's talk a little bit about increasing accessibility. Let's start with that. Mm-hmm. There's a number of things that need to happen to make ketamine treatment more broadly available and more accessible to people who need it. So here are some things that we can do right now. People can request racemic generic ketamine. It's dirt cheap. It's broadly available as a medical supply in most medical facilities. We should be using that and not the expensive patented S-ketamine product. It's insane to pay more for something that doesn't work better. So requesting racemic ketamine, number one. Number two, requesting injectable ketamine as much as possible. That's by far the fastest, cheapest, and easiest way of doing it. So cost savings there. Putting people into groups for group work when it's clinically appropriate. So some folks really need the individual attention of a therapist, particularly if they're working on traumatic material. But other folks do really well in groups. Excuse me, and it's actually beneficial to them, socially beneficial to be in a group. So that dramatically decreases the cost of ketamine treatment and makes it more accessible. So we should be thinking about that. And finally, you know, what really needs to happen is we need for providers to be working together to collect enough data to get insurance coverage and FDA approval for generic ketamine for a psychiatric indication. Because when we get FDA approval for this, then more medical insurances will cover this treatment, and that'll drop the price dramatically. And that's a good starting place for getting this medicine to more people. So there's a lot that we can do. Then there's a separate issue, or a related issue that you mentioned, which is making this medicine more accessible specifically to people who have been locked out of mental health treatments and research. So this is definitely an area that we need to be paying attention to. First of all, the medicine amplifies anything that could be happening in the room. And so if there's a power differential in the room between the clinical team and the client, if they're different in any axis of identity, the medicine may amplify all the meanings of that. So if they're different in terms of ethnicity or race, sexual orientation, gender, and religion, a lot of other things, it's really important that the clinical team is tuned in to what the meanings might be for the client, because all that could be amplified by the medicine. Let me give a better example of that. If I go for ketamine treatment, which by the way, I do, when I go to the clinician's office and they close the door behind me and lock it, I really just don't think anything of that. It makes me feel safe, and I think it's appropriate, and it didn't occur to me that that would be an issue, except that some colleagues of mine who identify as people of color pointed out that for someone who identifies as a person of color, if they're in a room with a clinician who identifies as white, and the white clinician goes and locks the door and tells the client that they're in a situation where the client is potentially immobilized and vulnerable and they're not allowed to leave, what does that mean? And again, for some clients, it's gonna be a non-issue, and for other clients, it's gonna be highly evocative and significant. And all of that needs to get addressed before introducing a powerful amplifier like ketamine. So that's what I mean when I talk about the power differential and issues related to that. And then, you know, Gisele, you and I were having a conversation the other day that I've been thinking about how different groups, different and people of different identities have been historically underserved in this country by the clinical community and by the research community. Mm-hmm. And I was really affected by what you said. We have to do better. Yes. We have to find ways to make all the treatments, all medical care, all psychological care, and psychedelic care in particular, how to make that available, particularly to the people who have been overlooked or neglected. So that's a conversation I'd like to have.
Yeah. And I was thinking about, you know, the power differential, the differences in racial, gender, sexuality, age, so many elements of identities that come into play when we're talking about healing, and how essential it is for healing to be able to have all parts of you present. And if a part of you is not feeling safe, even if it's that's just one element of your identity, how that is going to influence the ability to open up and heal. So I was talking to Rick Tarnas, and he and Stan Groff, in face of this conversation, he was telling me about some stories about Esalen in the 70s, that there was this psychiatrist who lived there, Dr., what was his name, Craig Enright, that was exploring ketamine with Stan Groff and Rick Tarnas. And they were doing injections, and they were mostly interested in extraordinary states of consciousness and a transdimensional exploration, as the 70s brought that about. But even back then, they had this kind of utopian vision of the future, that someday there could be some special centers, kind of part clinic, part of healing center, where individuals could come and they could be interviewed, they could be counseled, they could be taken into where they were at, and then be guided and be given options to deep exploration and healing, whether that would be breath work or body work, or in this case with what they were exploring, MDMA, ketamine, psilocybin, mescaline, LSD, just have a whole spectrum, but that the counseling would be a key element in that, and as well as in their vision, and I find that beautiful, the an astrological archetypal consultation. And so here we have some ideas of, you know, okay, you know, Stan Groff as being one of the grandfathers of the transpersonal field and somebody who really created a lot of validity to the transpersonal territory in terms of a psychedelic experience. And then we see, where are we at today, right? So if we think about this vision from them in the 70s at Esalen, something so unique, so privileged in so many ways, right? How do we then bring this vision forth in a way that's really serving the communities of the city, of the people who actually need access to this kind of healing and this kind of medicine that doesn't stay only with the privileged or those who can have access to it in through a very expensive way. So,
well, yeah, that's the problem. But I think people also have to take a step back and appreciate a little bit of, take a little bit of a historical perspective. I appreciate what you're, I mean, yes, we need to make it more accessible, and we will get there. And when I wrote my dissertation about this, I was writing in 2012 and I published in 2014. I can tell you that the number of people on earth who would admit to being interested in this topic, the use of ketamine in psychotherapy, and the number of people who had any experience with it on the entire planet Earth, is this many people? 5. And then the following, that was, so that's 2014. And then I had the first CRIA conference, which was supposed to be a lunch that turned into an international event. And, you know, we could barely get 24 people into the room. I mean, that was all the people that we could find, or that I could find. And then, you know, the next year was maybe 50 people who came. And then the next year was nearly 100 people who came. And now every year I get thousands of inquiries. So I say that to say that we're on a trajectory, a growth trajectory, that started with a small group of people who have been working really hard to bring this forward, to bring forward the idea that ketamine is pretty safe when it's supervised, that it's quite effective in treating certain disorders. Part of my agenda and part of our work group was to help people appreciate that the visions are potentially beneficial, may be central to the healing process, and that they're not something to be afraid of. So all of that has happened in like less than 7 years. So I think it's useful to look back at the history to say, wow, look at how far we've come in a short period of time, and to be hopeful about how far we're going to get in the next, you know, the next couple of years. So yes, there's still work to be done, and things are changing very rapidly, and in many ways changing for the better. So we're going to get there.
Yes. And so see us here today talking about this, and knowing that you are both a practitioner in this modality, mm-hmm. as well as a patient in this modality, mm-hmm. and how profound it is that you can come here and with a wide audience and speak about your experience and talk about that. So we've come a long ways, right? Is there something else about that, about your experience from being on both sides of this experience, both as a patient and as a therapist, that you would like to highlight?
Sure. Well, just to say that my interest in this topic is personal. I first encountered ketamine in 2002, so 19 years ago, in my own quest to find something to help me with my own severe and refractory depressive disorder that I've had most of my life and all of my adult life. I tried a variety of things underground, not so helpful. Then I bumped into ketamine and became friends with her, and that was life-changing for me. I thought somebody really ought to study this. It seemed to me at the time that it had rapid acting antidepressant or mood modulating effects. As I said, this was, you know, 19 years ago, and there was essentially nothing written about that. So I set out upon a quest to learn everything that I possibly could and to talk to people, all the while continuing ketamine treatment for myself. By the way, I discussed this in great detail, the whole colorful backstory. I describe it in an interview that I did with Mike Margolis a couple of years ago. And so hopefully we can put up the link for that and people can check it out if they want to hear exactly what happened. The importance of all this is that I wanted to say that much of what I teach to other clinicians and what I'm trying to put out in the world actually was informed by my experience as the patient. And I'm still a ketamine patient. I can say more about that in a second. But to that end, I think it's really valuable for clinicians who are interested in this space to have experiential training to the degree that is legal. So if it's accessible to them, it's really useful to have an experience as the client in learning how to navigate these vulnerable altered states. That getting ketamine, you know, I don't know that I did a great job of explaining it at the beginning, but so many people have an encounter with God. They spontaneously describe that they have an encounter of the divine or something sacred when they're working in the psychedelic range of ketamine and when that's really being held beautifully. And it's really hard to describe. It's ineffable. I think there's real value in people having, in clinicians in particular, having direct experience of these kinds of states in preparation for providing those experiences to clients. I think it makes them more compassionate and more sensitive and frankly, more effective. I wanted to just say one other thing that popped in my head as we head towards wrapping up here. But just to say that I openly myself, I get ketamine on a regular basis with a significant interval of time in between each journey. And I do that mostly for symptom reduction and symptom management reasons, but also because it's really meaningful. And I wanted to throw out the idea that for some people, it's possible to use ketamine or use a psychedelic medicine like ketamine in a spiritual practice that's closer to meditation or closer to yoga, in the sense that for me, working with ketamine is a practice that unfolds over time, and I keep returning to it, and the experience keeps deepening. And even though I've done it hundreds of times, literally hundreds of times in the last two decades, I feel like I'm always learning something new. And I have no desire whatsoever to use ketamine, even when I'm stressed, in between my scheduled appointments. That for me, that would ruin the sacredness of my relationship with it. So I don't use it in a casual way. But just to say that it is possible to have a long relationship with these medicines that I don't think constitutes a substance use disorder, but rather is something else, because me and other people like me are approaching it with reverence and respect. So I think that's a really important part of being in relationship to one of these sacred medicines.
Oh, I love to hear that. It's the process of a permanent transformation of consciousness, not necessarily just a peak experience. So the mystical consciousness here is about an engagement of an advancing the work, not only with temporary states, but with an advanced transformation. And I think that's what you're talking about. And in some way, this is very timing, because we are on the brink of a profound spiritual awakening, collectively and individually. So this is a wonderful tool, and you just explained it a beautiful way in which you're engaging with that. On that note, I will turn over to the questions that the audience has. And here it is, the first question from the audience. How can someone who has a negative home environment make the most of ketamine treatments?
I'm not totally sure what that means. What are you imagining? I wonder what the person is asking.
Well, I have an idea.
Okay.
When one engages in this deep, profound psychological healing that opens you up to non-ordinary states of consciousness, once you come out of that, you have to re-engage in regular life, right?
Yes.
After the ecstasy, there's the laundry, right? And so how do you, open your psyche, your body, your inner vulnerabilities to healing, and then go back home? And if there's tension there, or if there's ways in which somebody may feel unsafe in their home environment, how would they manage that process of integration after a psychedelic experience?
Okay, thank you for elaborating on that, because there's a lot in there. And I have a number of thoughts. Let me take a crack at this. So on a practical level, it's really important that people set aside time for their psychedelic exploration. And so I recommend to my students and my clients that they, the preparation really starts a couple of weeks before they, as they sort of move toward having a sacred session. But anyway, certainly the day before and the entire day of, and then in the following day, it's good to take a break from your regular routines to make space for the medicine to fully, so that you can fully experience it. And so to the degree that that's possible, again, making space, having a change of scenery, setting aside time for the ceremony is essential. So that's part of it on a practical level. But a couple of other things, we talk about ketamine as an antidepressant, and it's I actually think that that's not the exact right way to express it. Rather, ketamine appears to enhance resilience, because the reality is that people come in for a ketamine session, and whatever it is that's bothering them doesn't actually change during the 2 or 4 hours that they're with us. The parent is still ill, the spouse is still leaving, the job situation has deteriorated, the child with special needs still has those needs, and none of that actually changes in a real sense. What appears to change with ketamine treatment is people's willingness or ability to utilize coping strategies to engage with those ongoing problems. The situation doesn't change, but somehow people are fortified, find the energy and desire inside themselves to somehow deal with these challenges of this life. Okay, how are they dealing with these challenges? They're actually utilizing psychological skills and tools. The ketamine doesn't treat that, doesn't give that. The ketamine just makes people more receptive and helps people to remember or make use of those skills. Where are those skills coming from? Well, either you have a mentor, or you're learning it from a book, or you have a spiritual teacher, or you're going to psychotherapy. Any of those would work. But the tools, the skills have to come from somewhere. So again, we come back to this idea of ketamine and psychotherapy working together. The chemical alone isn't going to do it. The chemical alone is a two-hour vacation from the problem, and then you come right back into the same situation. And that's the reality of it, and that's the problem with using ketamine as just as a chemical.
Yeah. Second question here coming from Jeremy. He says, I'm a nurse and wondering if you could talk about the use of ketamine or other psychedelic substances within a hospice setting. Mm-hmm. Do you suggest one become involved in this kind of work in hospice?
I do. Mm-hmm. So ketamine is used quite a bit already for analgesia or pain management for people in hospice. And it's often used when the patient doesn't tolerate opioids well, or when they're not working well enough. So I say that because most hospice workers, staff, and physicians are already very familiar and comfortable with using this tool. What's newer is the idea of using ketamine, or rather using ketamine-facilitated psychotherapy or psychedelic ketamine journeys to help people prepare for their own deaths. Okay, so that's a little bit on the edge there, but I think there's some real value in this, particularly for patients who explicitly express the desire to, you know, to work with that material. The thing is that ketamine can sort of briefly mimic some elements of dying because it quiets the signal from the body to the brain. And so for a little bit, it's like the volume is turned down on your sensory perception when you're under the influence of ketamine. And that effect gets more and more intense as the dose goes up. Where I wanted to go with that is that ketamine gives people the opportunity to practice or rehearse being dead, or rather having their consciousness and their awareness separated from their body for a brief time, and then you come back. And this often opens up really rich material that you can explore in psychotherapy, either as you contemplate your own death or the loss of people who are close to you. So anyway, all of that to say that I think ketamine is a really useful tool in hospice and in other situations. And there's some research being done on this. And I think we're gonna see more publications about this. And it's really an exciting sort of new frontier. Mm-hmm. So
the last question here, it's about the comment that you made that ketamine might not be optimal for PTSD, but how can ketamine be more useful for anxiety and PTSD?
Yeah, I'm glad you asked. I didn't want to go too far. I didn't have the opportunity to go into that too deeply, but let's unpack that a little bit. Couple things. There's a couple considerations. Okay, so first of all, MDMA works really well for treating lots of kinds of PTSD, and so it'll be wonderful when that's more broadly available. I understand that it's hard to access now. But anyway, in thinking about PTSD, we have to first think about different subtypes of PTSD. There's different kinds of trauma, and they respond differently to different kinds of treatment. The treatment and the prognosis is very different depending on what kind of trauma you're working on. This is very relevant to ketamine treatment. So some of the things to be thinking about if you're the clinician are, what kind of trauma was it? Was it accidental or relational? Was it an act of God? Was it at one time? Was it repeated? How old was the client at the time of the prominent trauma or traumas? Did it happen before they were 10 and before the personality was formed, the trauma that they want to work on? Did the trauma happen, when they got a little bit older and they had more capacity to think about or talk about the impact of that trauma? Anyway, I say all that because ketamine is probably reasonably safe and probably pretty helpful for working with accidental traumas that occurred a little bit later in life. For example, there's a lot of evidence that says that ketamine can be quite helpful in treating post-combat vets when they come back and they're struggling with physical pain, depression, and trauma. And it seems like adding ketamine into the treatment mix seems to give really good results. But we have to unpack that to really understand what it means. The hypothesis there is that the trauma that they're working on was accidental, not personal, but combat situation, probably done not by somebody that they knew, but again, combat situation, and that the trauma occurred later in life, so after the personality was formed. So in those kinds of cases, using ketamine is probably pretty safe. The places where things get trickier are when the trauma occurred earlier in life or when it was relational. So when the client was being hurt by somebody that they knew, or when it was repeated or earlier in life. It's not that we never use ketamine in those cases, but in those kinds of cases, the therapeutic alliance is even more important than it already is ordinarily. Because the relationship, the trust and the love between the client and the therapist, that's the thing that's needed to be the glue to hold the treatment together when things get wonky with ketamine. Because ketamine can be a disorienting experience. Also, if the client experienced dissociative trauma at any time, if they felt like they were coming out of their own body at the time that something bad was happening, the thing is that if you put ketamine in, it's a chemical dissociative, people will remember that feeling of coming out of their body is associated with something really catastrophic happening, and they will find that distressing and they will naturally resist it. Anyway, just to say that in those kinds of cases, it's not that we never use ketamine, it's that we do it very carefully. And that was really the point that I wanted to make earlier, was to do it with caution. Could you give a bag of ketamine to a combat vet with minimal trauma history or no trauma history, if anybody has that? Could you give a bag of ketamine with minimal psychotherapy, and that might be a little bit helpful? Probably. Would it be safe to give a bag of ketamine, a ketamine infusion with minimal psychotherapy or no psychotherapy, to somebody with a history of relational or dissociative trauma? You can't do that. That's not a smart idea. There's not good evidence that that's effective, number one, and likely to cause distress. So I've gotten hundreds of unsolicited complaints over the years. Unsolicited. People are just like finding me on the internet and writing to me and telling me about their difficult ketamine experiences. And a lot of them are talking about being accidentally triggered in their ketamine experience into revisiting a trauma that they weren't expecting to or prepared to deal with. And then they got emotionally overwhelmed, either because they didn't have enough emotional support or not enough connection or whatever. Anyway, all of that is to say that these things need to be done very gently and thoughtfully. That it's good for the therapist and the client to know each other well. It's good for the therapist to have skills in working with trauma. And so that's kind of where we're at, I think, for now. Another possibility, by the way, down the road is that we'll combine ketamine and MDMA treatment. That's another, or that ketamine could be used with another classic psychedelic to help people. So that's much harder to study because of the bureaucratic red tape, but I think there are some interesting things just around the corner.
Yeah. I very good message around the importance of being trauma-informed, and that trauma is a phase treatment, and how important it is to have phase one with resources, with safety, with a good solid clinical connection, and that is the foundation to be able to engage in any kind of psychedelic experience. Another few more questions here. Do you think that clinical or therapeutic administration will be open to non-medical professionals once training and education is more comprehensive?
Non-medical and non-licensed people? Is that what they mean?
Well, they mean therapists and psychologists.
Well, will the training be open to them? Is that what they're asking?
That's what they're asking.
I think the training is open to anybody who's interested. I think I'm not, well, there's a number of different training programs and each one has different requirements. So it's rapidly evolving. By the way, there's a list, I keep a list of trainings that I think highly of on my website. And so maybe someone will put that in the chat for me.
Then another question here.
Well, go ahead.
If you have any experience with the use of ketamine in couples or family therapy.
Yeah, happy to answer that also. Just to go back for a second. One possibility that I think the clinical community is talking about is whether or how you could incorporate unlicensed folks like guides into a treatment model. And I think that might be possible if they were working in, if the guide was working in collaboration with a licensed professional. That's a longer conversation, but I think something that a lot of people are thinking about. Then in terms of couples and family therapy, this is such an interesting question, and I thank you to whoever asked it. The problem here is legality. It comes back to legality. Is it legal is it legally defensible? In other words, if you're a clinician and you get called in front of the state board, we didn't talk about this earlier, is it defensible? Can you defend your license from being removed if you were to give ketamine because the patient wanted it? And the answer is, it depends on the board, and these things are changing all the time. Up until recently, in order for you to give ketamine to a couple, each member of the couple had to separately qualify with a qualifying psychiatric diagnosis in order to receive it. Now there's a new idea coming forward, which is that ketamine might be useful in couples therapy to connect with each other or enhance communication or whatever. Does it work? Yeah, I think it works. I think everything I've seen to date suggests that that might be useful. Is it legally defensible? It just depends on how much risk you can stomach as a provider, but I think some state boards would not look kindly on that. This leads me actually into another point I wanted to make. So if you'll indulge me for a second, which is the following thought. We're really in a quandary. We're really kind of stuck. And here's where we're stuck in the field, in the field of ketamine as a whole. Where we're stuck is that where we're kind of at right this second, is that we accept that ketamine is reasonably safe when it's used in a contained environment or in the hands of professionals who are highly trained and experienced. We accept that ketamine is pretty darn safe for people who are medically fragile. So people who are, lying on the roadside in a car accident, or people who are in a long operating, operation, or people who are of advanced age. We know that ketamine can be used for these populations and can be reasonably physically safe, as I said, when used correctly, okay? We've got that on one side, medically safe over here. What we've got over here is we have a lot of data, a lot of research data that says that ketamine is probably pretty safe and effective when used in a low dose range for people who are psychiatrically fragile. I hate that expression, but that's the expression that they use. People who are bipolar, people who have severe depressive disorder, people who want to kill themselves, we accept that ketamine is probably safe and effective and useful for this population when it's used in a supervised and thoughtful way. Okay, these are the bookends. So if we accept that, if we know that this is true, high dose ketamine and for medical procedures and low dose ketamine for people with significant psychiatric illness, it makes no sense. It's absurd to argue that ketamine is somehow not safe for everybody else who's physically more healthy or psychologically more healthy in this moderate dose range. It makes no sense because we've already established the bookends. So this is really where the field needs to go, is studying the safety and efficacy of ketamine as an adjunct to psychotherapy for people who are basically functioning pretty well. So this is the legal gray zone, I think, that we're grappling with.
Yeah, and if I may add something in this ketamine-assisted psychotherapy, especially for couples and families, what might be more useful is a psycholytic use, which is more of an ego loosening rather than a psychedelic, which be more of an ego dissolving, because the focus of that treatment would be more on the relational level.
Exactly.
Yeah. So other questions here. Question from Sam, and I think I'm going to respond to this one, Raquel, because the question is, how can I pursue a career in psychedelic, likely specifically ketamine-assisted therapy, and what are the good grad programs to look into, and what kind of relevant work experience would be suitable and attainable prior to grad school? And so the answer to this question is, you are seeing this program here at CIIS, and we do have lots of graduate programs in psychology with different orientations, and they all lead into a path that could be of psychedelic assisted psychotherapy. We also have a certificate in-house that trains people in that way. And what is relevant work experience that is suitable prior to grad school is teaching, mentoring, working with people, and also personal work. So we do look for people who have already an engagement with their own healing process and have, and through psychotherapy, through any kind of spiritual practice, but in some way are interested in evolving and transforming into their own histories of trauma, their own family dynamics, and their own ways of dealing with life, and have done some kind of work that is with people or related with people that has given them an opportunity to develop their awareness, their communication skills, their relational capacities. So those are the prerequisites that we look for our graduate students. But I do encourage and suggest look on CIIS website for those grad programs. But of course, one can take those grad programs in any other school. So pretty much a degree in counseling psychology, clinical social work, nurse, psychiatry, those would be the main ones. Do you have anything to add on that front, Raquel?
You're so articulate, Gisele. Do I have anything to add? So a really easy place to start is to learn meditation. You can learn that for free online. But cultivating the capacity to observe your own mind with interest and curiosity, and to just get really curious about what's going on in between your ears, that's a good, easy place for that anybody could start right now. And then to add to what you said, having your own psychotherapy and getting to know your own issues and getting more familiar with your internal landscape, having your own psychedelic experience, if it's legal and safe for you to do that, that's really, really valuable. And then volunteer work. I worked for a couple of years before applying to grad school at a cancer center, and that really kind of profoundly shaped my clinical practice and my views. So all of those things are things that one could get started on before even throwing down the money for graduate school.
Thank you. It was wonderful to have this time today here with you and to engage in conversation. And I look forward to many more opportunities to do that as the field continues to evolve and we continue to expand the access and include different ways of providing the treatment and evolving in in what has been already worked with. Anything you would like to add as we come to the end of our time today?
These are exciting times. I can't believe how rapidly the field is changing, and I can't wait to see where we're at in a couple of years from now. And welcome to everybody in the field who's coming in, who's interested. We're excited to meet you and work with you.
Thank you for being here tonight, Raquel, and thank you for all your work.
It's a pleasure. Thank you so much for having me.
Yeah, so on this note, I will invite Jason to come back.
Thank you all so much for attending today. We hope you will join us for more of our upcoming talks and workshops. This conversation was recorded. If you'd like to watch it again or share it with your community, it will be available on our YouTube channel at this same link and on our Facebook page. We will also feature this talk on our podcast, which you can find at www.ciispod.com or by searching CIIS Public Programs on your favorite podcast app. Thanks again for joining us, and good night.